so much. Yeah. This is lovely. We're going to do a song now. Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you. I've been sitting here so long for you to hear my song. Okay. But all you want to know, have I been on the radio?
I had a chance of making a living. I could get a shovel and go and walk in a building site, or get a paintbrush and go painting, or get a guitar and go and sing.
And if I get a job, would I sing on my arms?
I never expected anything else other than if I could make enough money to keep me and my family.
I'd sing songs of the sun, and when my job was done, I would say I love you so, and I'd like to play one more, just to all young lovers for the role.
It's just fantastic to work at something you love.
Tell me, sir, yeah, just how far I need to go to be a star.
I used to be in the building trade years ago, and I got asbestos about 30, 40 years ago, and it takes that long to come out, you know. So it's finally shown itself.
We really discovered something was wrong after the tour. We did a great nationwide tour, March, April, of Ireland. It was a fabulous tour. We loved it. Christy enjoyed every single standing ovation, which he never ever expected standing ovation. So each standing ovation to him was very precious. But every single time before he'd go on stage, he wasn't able to breathe, he wasn't able to sing. And getting up there doing a 2.5 hour performance was quite a miracle. So we came off tour, and unfortunately, he was diagnosed with the illness.
About 5 months ago, they told me I had 3 months to live. The first few weeks were hard, because I thought, well, that's the end, like, you know. But then I thought, well, it's only the end if I let it be the end, you know. And every day that I'm here, I can make the best of. It's okay to feel angry for a while, I believe, but even anger can turn on you. So I got angry for a little while and then let go of the anger, because I don't think that serves much purpose either. But it's good to be a little bit angry for a while, but not to hold on to it. So that's what I do. That's one of the tricks. And then I pray a lot. So, you know, to whoever or whatever, you know, I just send up prayers and then try and think positive. I always remember a story my mum told me. They told my mum she had 6 months to live. They said, we're very sorry, but you got 6 months to live. And about 5 years after, she was telling me this, you know, that the doctor told her. But when she left the doctor's surgery, she said, I was really glad I looked at the door and seen doctor. And she said, not God, doctor. So she said, and seeing that it wasn't God that told me that, I thought, no, you can't tell me 6 months. However long it takes, it's going to take that time. And so she lived for 12 years after that. So I've kind of lived by that. Since I've been told that matter, you know, is that nobody can tell you we're going to die, you know, nobody knows.
I have known my highs and lows. I've worked in every show. I've played in every town and brought some houses down. Yet critics never notice me. I'm not a star, you see. And yet I give my heart to every part.
We were all just, well, let's just get on with it. We've got albums to make, we've got tours, and let's see how long we can take this. So, you know, for the first few months, Christy was surprising the doctors. He was going on long walks and he was singing, and he'd written this album.
I don't know who you're talking to. After all I do for you.
The only thing I thought was that because he'd never drunk, taken a drug, smoked in his life, been unhealthy, not eaten well, because he had such a positive outlook on life. I thought there was a chance that he might be able to make a year and a half, 2 years, that I might be able to kind of get him to that point, or help him get to that point.
I was told I wouldn't be able to walk up the stairs, so then I went for a walk every day. And instead of walking for a quarter of a mile, I walk for two miles a day now. And I was told I wouldn't sing again, which I've recorded most of the album. So that's it really, you know. So got me back in it.
Just when I left school, like, you know, I got a job as a messenger boy. And I fell in love with this lovely girl. She was about 40, like, and I was about 12. But, anyway, she was a lovely girl. Gone the saddle of my old red mare. Oh, right through the night without a worry or a care. I'm a messenger by bringing my love to you. A messenger by bringing my love to you. Yeah.
When I was about six or seven, Jolly Crack at the end of our road in Kirsten's Avenue, made a guitar out of a tea chest, and he put not gut or anything on it, but all bits of string. And I used to go in the pub and sing all these songs, and this string used to be flapping up and down. I was really good though. Everyone said so. Absolutely hated school, hated everything about it, hated the teachers, hated the building, hated the idea of learning. I asked my mum if I could leave school when I was 11 and a half, and she said, when you're 12, you can go. So I told the headmaster, I said, I asked my mum if I could leave school, and she said, when I'm 12, I can leave. And it took him a while to recognise me, because he hadn't seen me very often. So. Anyway, he said to me, when you leave school at 12, what are you going to do? And as I opened my mouth to tell him, he said to me, shall I tell you what you're going to do? And I said, yes, please. He said, nothing. He said, because when you leave school at 12, there is nothing to do. I felt really sorry for him, you know. There was so much to do, I mean, I couldn't begin to tell him. And he didn't even know at that time I was going to be a star. I was doing the four clubs in the 1972-1973, and just around this constant circle, trying to make a living at that. It was hard, and why I kept going, I don't know. And it was like I was like a bull, you know, just kept hitting my head off the gate, you know.
He'd sort of leave home at 6 o'clock in the morning and go up ladders and paint and decorate, and he'd come home at sort of four and he'd get changed and he'd take his guitar and he'd go out and he'd gig, and sometimes he wasn't paid and sometimes he couldn't get home and he would have to travel on freight trains, and I knew he was walking around in the dark on his own, and by God he had some stories about those times.
I do a folk club the same Wales, and at the end of the gig you then say, is there anybody got a spare floor tonight? So I could sleep on. And then hopefully somebody would come up and say yes. And they did sometimes. And I remember going back to a house one night and they put me into the kitchen. Laid out a blanket on the floor in the kitchen. So the husband and wife went off to bed. Then about 4 hours later, there was an almighty kick of the kitchen door. And the two of them came in, beat mother on the floor. So I'm lying here, you know. So this is not just unusual, this happens a lot in different respects, you know. And so I packed up my stuff and got my guitar in and squeezed out the door and went out and sat in the station for the night, the railway station. There was lots of nights like that.
Christy gave me a bed for the night in 1968. I remember him singing all of these incredible songs to me, you know. I'd never heard anything like this. And the most unusual style of playing the guitar. And his voice was incredible.
Mr. Sandman told me in a dream you were going to leave me. What a funny dream.
I said, are you doing any gigs around London? And he told me he was working on the building site. I said, what are you working on the building site for? And he said, I do a few bars the weekend. I said, I'll Ambrose, don't know who looks after us, you know, so I got Ambrose interested in it, and Ambrose got him to make his very first album.
I was making an album in 1972 for a label called Westwood in West Montgomery in Wales. The first day, I put down about 7 tracks, and he said, you need another song, really, you know, there's one more song to go on this album. Yeah. I sat down with the guitar, and I come up with this little blues riff, ba-da-da-da-dum-bum-bum, ba-da-da-da-dum-bum-bum, and just almost from beginning to end, don't forget your shovel if you want to go to work, don't forget to, it just happened, don't forget your shovel if you want to go to work.
Christy's first album is still one of my favourite albums of all time. A very, very unique album.
Christy then rang me and said, I'm going to record Don't Forget Your Shovel. And he said, make sure you're publishing. So I said, brilliant. So I got a publisher and I published the song. And Christy did his version of Don't Forget Your Shovel, which is fantastic, I love. And got to number one for him.
It turned my career around. I went from being a folk singer who played in folk clubs to going on to bigger things on the back of that song.
Sunshine's on my baby, sunshine's on my love.
I met my wife in Water Street in the discotheque. It was about 11:30 and I seen this girl with 3 or 4 more girls. So I thought, God, she's lovely, you know. So I went up and I said, would you like to dance, you know? So she looked at me like that, as if I had 2 heads. And one of the other girls pushed her, you know, and she just kind of came into my arms and we started dancing, you know. And we about 4 o'clock in the morning, she went off home, but she gave me her number. And then a few days later, I rang her, and then we went to the pictures. And then I knew that night that I was going to ask her to marry me. I thought, there is no other girl, this is the one. So we came outside and she said, where are we? What's that up there, the sign? And I said, that's a sign. She said, no, what's the name on it? And I said, she said, you got bad eyesight, haven't you? I said, yeah, nearly blind girl. So I said, where is it? And so we get up close to it and I said, can you not see it? And she said, no, it's really blonde. I said, well, I can't see it either. And for some unknown reason, I think she clocked it. She doesn't think so, but I thought she'd think, he can't read that sign, you know. And then once I told her that, and she said, it doesn't matter, we'll find ways around it, you know. I knew then she was definitely the right one, you know. Because that's a hard call, you know, to go with somebody with no job, no prospects, and can't read and write.
Sunshine is my baby. Sunshine is my love. Sunshine is... Sunshine is my love.
I'd just like to introduce you to the rest of the band, you know, and on the fiddle is my daughter, Amber. And vocals is my other daughter, Hermione.
He knew the value of family and the power of it. He dragged me up on stage since I was tiny. You know, he said, you have an extraordinary voice. And this is something we have to do. But I was a foil in a way. I never said anything, really. But he used me to his full advantage on stage. I think he thought to have a gift and not use it was pretty unforgivable, I guess.
My children are very, very important. Where Hermione's concerned, she's a real strong go-getter and make things happen. You know, and I'm very important to her, I know that. She lets me know that every day. And since I've had this illness, and before, nothing's been too much for her to do for me, you know. And particularly around now, she's just gone the hell for leather, you know, making things happen. It's constant, 24 hours a day, she's there for me, you know.
He made music so exciting. He taught me chords, 3 chord tricks and stuff like that, you know. you know, I learned how to play the violin. That was, you know, the first thing. I think I was about four or something, and he was like, what do you want to do? And there was a violin on the wall, and I was like, I want to play that, and that's it. Immediately, he sort of, you know, got lessons for me and stuff like that. And he was like, right, how about the guitar? How about the guitar, you know, and I was rubbish. So he sort of put the guitar down, and then out came a mandolin, and then a harmonica, and then, you know, and he'd sort of try and teach me each of these instruments.
Amber is a lot more laid back and soft and very delicate, you know, and I know what she feels for me, you know, where she's come from a 10-year, probably 12 years of drugs, and to come from where she was to where she is now is just absolutely amazing. You'd have to look at her and go, this is somebody you could actually put up on a pedestal and say, like, I can achieve anything in life. She's just an amazing little girl, you know.
He completely made every day of my life fun. He'd take me out for walks every afternoon, and if it was raining, he'd go under his jacket, and whilst he'd be walking down the street, he'd write songs that you have to join in and sing, and he'd do it to the rhythm of the rain and the walking. I've got loads of those things.
My dad would write the lyrics to the music that I'd written, and I never disagreed with one thing he ever said. And anything I kind of had a little bit of a niggling, I thought, oh no, I'm not too sure about that. He'd change it, and he felt exactly the same way about the music. It's just like we just read each other's minds, we knew what each other was thinking.
He's an amazing musician, an amazing writer, fantastic songwriter, a fantastic musician, but nothing is ever, ever too much trouble. No matter if I said to him, like, I'm coming to John's, which is a 2.5-hour journey, and the record company said they'd pay the minicab to bring me from the house here. And he's up in the morning, no, I'll take you because I can play you the records you like. You can have a pillar behind you, you can go to sleep, you can, no, you're coming to camp. So he'll drive 3 hours it took us to get here, and he'll take 2.5 hours or 3 hours back. And then he phones up and he says, I'm home, you all right? And I go, yeah. And he's 22, like, you know. So, and that is constant.
My dad was my best friend, my soulmate. We spent every day in the coffee shop together, talking, music, and everything else. And then we got back home, and he was my dad again, and he played a father role. But as soon as we walked out the door in the mornings, he was my mate, he was my best friend. And when we went on tour, it was all about music. And then he played, you know, the role of teacher, really.
I could tell, well, in each one of them, I could tell, this is the kind of character you're going to be, and this is the one you're going to be, and this one, and they haven't disappointed me. They have grown up to be those, exactly those characters.
Oh, the road is longer than I planned for an ordinary man. In my life, I need a helping hand. I'm an ordinary man. I have given all I've got. I have won and I have lost.
He had a lot of bad luck. And I think there are a hell of a lot of bad luck stories out there in music. But I knew I was sitting with somebody who was utterly extraordinary. I watched him go through so much and so much pain and anguish, but in a very gentle way. He was incredibly humble with it.
I was on this tour one time in Manchester. And one morning I got up and I put a record on the record player and started listening to Al Jolson. And for some unknown reason, I started criticising the arrangements. And I just sat there thinking, I always liked Al Jolson, and his arrangements are like the best. What's the matter with this one? You know? And I went through this in my head, and I was circling around. And then I looked up, and it was 12 o'clock. So I'd been there like 3 hours, just trying to arrange this Al Jolson piece of music. You know, I don't know if people know, but Al Jolson was dead for years. It wasn't going to change anything. So I phoned my wife and I said to her, I'm coming home, you know. She said, you know, you're only halfway through the tour. I said, I can't, there's some reason that I said I have to come home. She said, okay. So then I got the train and got home and I told her what happened. And I started, like a demented man, going through my collection to get all the Al Jolson albums out. I started playing the records and then started arranging them again. So she came out and said, it's 2:30. You know, she said, like, it's the same song. I said, yeah, but it's the same arrangement. So she said, what the freaking hell are you on about? So I said, no matter how many times I play this and I've said that that's the wrong arrangement, they're still playing the same arrangement. So I said, right, yeah, okay. They'll probably change it in the morning. Now you come to bed. So I went off to bed, and the next day we went to see the doctor, and he suggested that I put on this lovely little white jacket and go for a walk with him. So Jill said, she's going to look after me. This, I'm not going anywhere. And he's not taking any tablets, she said. I've got to have him at home. So then she spent 3 months looking after me while I just sat there looking out the window and looking at the record player, dying to play the record. She's put tape around us, like, so not playing that. So, it was just 3 months of hell. And then one day I got up and I thought, now I can go out. I'm going to go out. And she was elated, she was delighted. So I said, you should just try and go for a walk first of all. I said, no, I'm going to phone my brother. My brother was in England at that time. And I phoned him, I said, where are you working? He said, I'm working on a building site in Victoria. And I said, do you think I could get a job there? He said, yeah, come down in the morning. So I went down there, got a train down there, met him there, and started walking. I was much happier. The crack was really good. The tea breaks were great. So I stayed there for a while, you know. And then after a while, just said to me, you should play the guitar. And I said, yeah, I know I should. But just looking at it was hard, you know. So then I picked it up and started playing it. And I really started to enjoy it and then write songs, a few more songs. And I thought, I'll give it another go on the tour thing, you know. In the meantime, John Peel had heard my record said to come on the show and do a few songs for him on his show. So we went along and we did 3 songs on the John Peel show, and it just opened the door. You know, like the universities start ringing, colleges are ringing. Would you play in the uni tonight, in the uni hall tonight? And the money went up, you know. So, but my wife had always told me, she said, if you stay at £7, they won't respect you. You know, she said, you should say £20. And it's amazing because I was charging £7. I used to have to, when I got to the gig, this would be the stage. My guitar would be here. I'd take the guitar, tune it up, walk on the stage and sing. And I get my £7. I charged them £20. They found me a room so I could tune up the guitar. All of a sudden, I'm doing the same old songs, same old jokes, but all of a sudden, because I'm charging more money, they've now given me a room of my own. So that I'm like, I'm somebody special. Well, I'm enjoying myself anyway. And you're paying for it. Thanks very much.
He was incredibly sharp. He was very smart. He was terribly wise. But he would never hurt anybody, even those that were out for themselves or prepared to hurt him. He wouldn't.
I saw so many people, you know, take advantage of Christy years and years ago and his wonderful music, you know, because he was such a beautiful man, you know, such a docile human being. You know, behind his back there was a lot of messing going on, you know.
People would come into his life and then they'd leave, and then other people would kind of sing his songs, and then somebody wouldn't pay their royalties. He'd been gobbled up a few times in the past, and my first interest was protecting him and protecting his rights. And because he was just the loveliest man in the world, you just wanted to help him anyway. And I don't know, I don't think you can be too nice for this industry.
I've seen him performing on stage, and I've seen people coming away from gigs almost suggesting that Christie's persona is an act, that he couldn't be for real. And of course the reality is, he is for real. You know, it's not an act. He is that beautiful man we see on the stage. He is that beautiful man we hear in his albums. There's such compassion within him, you know. He's real.
He had everything going for him, you know, absolutely everything. And I did believe in him from the start. I just thought he was a wonderful person with a wonderful talent that hadn't been recognised, and that it was one of the travesties of this, you know, this industry, that he hadn't been recognised for what he had done and what he had to offer.
His personality leaps through his voice. It's a totally individual personality. And when you hear it for the first time, no matter how broad-minded you are, in the business you're conditioned to sort of think or to sort of narrow your vision somehow to try and conform with some notion this business might have about itself. And when the first time you hear Christie's voice, first time I heard his voice, I kind of went, wow. But they'll never go for that, because they're too cynical, and this is too individual, and it's too sweet, and it's too real.
When I was about 43, Ambrose Donohue said, why don't you go out and do a gig in Ireland, just one gig, please. And Ambrose really believed in me all those years, you know, so I said, but who'd come out and see me, Ambrose? I've never played in Ireland. And he said, well, there's a guy back there, Derek Nally, he'll put you into Whelan's, a place called Whelan's, and he's going to get an audience. I said, you know, I feel really bad for him. I said, turn up and then pay my flight, pay my hotel, and then he's going to give me money. And then I said, are you joking? I said, I couldn't do it. So Derek rang me and he said, look, I'd love you to come over. And he said, that's my responsibility, getting the audience and the money. So a few months later, I went back and got to the Whelan's that night, and there was a crowd outside the door. Cue. So I thought, ooh, who else is on here? So anyway, I goes in and done the gig, and it was a fantastic night. Full house, audience were brilliant. I think I had a stand ovation. It's amazing.
I went to Whelan's and I can quite honestly say that within 2 or 3 minutes of Christie being on stage, I just loved him. I just stayed through for the whole show, met them afterwards, Hermione and Christie, and said, look, I really want to do something. Let's get working.
After that, it really just took off. We did the rehearsal. I Am a Star was on there. That never came off the radio for months and months, and it went straight into the charts. And after that, I went with Warners and did an album called A Year in the Life. It went to number one for 7 weeks, and it was just an amazing time. I walked out on the stage in Failure, and it's nerve-wracking. And this is a new audience to me. They're all young. Obviously, open air concert. Thank you.
Guess I don't feel too bad now.
You have a dream when you first start out of playing to people like that amount of people, but you never imagine it coming through for you. But it did. And it's magic. It's brilliant.
All the work tonight, the show is going to see the light of day. Let the dancers take the stage and let the music play. Tonight we'll do it as they would on
It would have been around 1989, 1990, and my sound man at the time, Dan, was telling me all about this amazing singer, songwriter, comedian, because he just would talk about the stories he told on stage and how funny he was, you know.
Me and my brother, like, you know, we used to put on a show for my mother every Saturday afternoon, like, you know, and she used to just sit on the old chair, like, you know, at the top of the living room, and we used to dress up into different acts and do a song for her, like, you know. And he was my older brother, like, he used to be Elvis, you know, and I used to be Connie Francis. I didn't mind being Connie Francis singing like her, but dressing up was a bit much, I think.
I did my first solo album in 1991. I was still looking around for, you know, songs that I might like to sing. As it ended up, I wrote most of it myself, except for one song. And that one was one of Christie's. and it was a song called Jealous Heart.
Oh, jealous heart, how you lied. You let me go without a word. I travel far, set new routes, and seeds I've sown and now have grown.
Jealous Heart, myself and Kenny Craddock wrote. One evening we were sitting down, we had our fish and chips, because we were down in Brighton, so we had our fish and chips, brought them back, sitting down eating our fish and chips, and he played his track, and to me it just said, Jealous Heart. The first word that came into my head when I heard the track being played was Jealous Heart, and I thought, this is going to be a really easy song to write, because this is Ireland. This is a song about Ireland, people leaving Ireland, and she being jealous of you leaving.
Oh, love of life, oh, life of love.
Jealous heart. Jealous heart.
I never knew, oh, jealous heart.
The Dalai Lama has been visiting Derry. He's taking part in the celebrations for the 10th anniversary of the local charity, Children in Crossfire.
I started Children in Crossfire in 1996 to support projects in Africa and Asia and South America. Probably based on my own experience through being shot and blinded by a rubber bullet as a child. I really want the Christie as a patron for the charity. It's great for the issues that we're involved in, that somebody like him lends his name to us.
We were just driven up to villages that Children in Crossfire had been working with, and we just got out of the cars or the jeeps, and the children just ran towards us. They grabbed beautiful yellow flowers off the trees, and then we just thought, well, there's no other communication we can do except for singing nursery rhymes, singing songs we knew.
The Dalai Lama agreed to come to Derry in July 2007, and we've been planning the thing for a year. So it was a great honour for me and an enormous privilege when myself and the Dalai Lama were standing at the side of the stage and Christie was singing the song that he wrote for Children in Crossfire.
Once I sang the song, he stood at the side of the stage and he was waving, so the audience were there and I'm waving.
The day was a very magical day because the soldier that shot Richard Moore and blinded him was at the venue as well, because Richard Moore had made contact with the soldier a year previously, hadn't told us, but then said to the audience, well, actually, you know, I've got my friend here who's going to come up and say hello, and he's the soldier, right? And the soldier came up on stage and they embraced and they explained that they had been talking to each other for the past year. And Dalai Lama said, you know, he was holding Richard Moore's hand and he said, this man here, he says, my hero.
Everywhere he went, he was holding Richard's hand. He did three engagements during the day, and the first thing he said in each engagement was, I am so proud to be here with my hero.
It was a very moving day for everyone, and we wrote this song called When Will We Learn.
Myself and John Timmis had written a song which would really suit Christie and Luca, but getting the two of them together would be a bit of a job and a half, because they've never sang together before on record. So I thought, well, if I don't ask, I don't get, you know. So I phoned Christie and I said, you wouldn't do a duet with yourself and Luca and myself, would you? And so I'd love to, absolutely love to sing me the song and I'd have listened to it.
I really love the song. I love what it's about. I love the story behind the song. It's a very, very big song on this island because of what it's about. You know, it's about reaching out, it's about forgiveness, it's about love, and I'm so happy to be part of it.
I just heard the song and I immediately found myself singing it and loving it, and I couldn't wait for the opportunity to sing with the two Christies.
When will we learn? When will we learn?
Oh yeah, it really worked.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It really does.
That's a good day's work, isn't it?
Oh, it's a great day's work, man.
There is a link across the water, so close and yet so far away.
When his health started deteriorating rapidly, it became apparent that it might be a good time to bring other people in, to bring other artists in, to really acknowledge what Christie had done.
We were in for a meeting in Universal with Dave Pennyfeather one day, and we said that we had Christie Moore on board, and he'd done the track. So then Dave said, you know, what about a duets album as well as the singles album? What about all your old songs on a duets album and then your new songs on a single album? So in my head, I'm saying, like, that's a great idea, but who's going to want to sing duets with me? So I went through this list, and everyone they suggested, I thought, this is not going to happen. But all of them are people I would have loved to do duets with. Over the next few months, it started to come back that, oh, Paul Brady's on board, Mary Black's on board, Francis on board.
Do you think you'll get a chance to do Jealous Heart vocals?
I don't think I'd, even if I did, I don't know if I'm vocally up to it.
You say that every day?
Yeah.
I don't know what. Every day he says, oh, I don't think I can do that one. And then he does two vocals.
And there's four.
And then he comes back the next day. Are we going to do that song? Yeah. Oh, I don't think I can sing that. And then he sings it.
I'm in shock because I didn't think these people would want to do duets with me, you know. But they do. I must be more famous than I thought I was.
A messenger boy, bringing my love to you.
It's bringing all his music back. It's bringing it all back home again, almost. And it's great to see everybody coming around and to do duets and be a part of all Christie's work.
All men scheming and planning.
It was songs like Star that inspired me to be a singer. So the relevance of me being involved in this record was because of that. It's almost a thank you to Christie from me for what he gave me.
Hiding away with no fear. Tears. But they're never on the mountains or the moon above. They're never on the stars or fall in love. They never ever realize what they've done. Taking someone else's son.
He was a mind-blowing performer. His humor, his banter with the audience, everything about him, he brings you into everything he says. I remember there was a noise coming out of the monitor on the stage, and his exact words, and I thought I'd cripple myself laughing, was, oh, there's a bastard of a mouse in that monitor.
You never told me, jealous heart.
It's nice to come in to play the banjo and the whistle with him and support his songs, you know. And I cried my eyes out there with the banjo a few minutes ago. Jealous Heart is this piece of music I'm doing, you know, with him. beautiful song that he wrote. I remember him singing it, the original, years ago. And to hear him singing it again, it's lovely.
Is this the end to the older show? I've played this part so long, my friend.
Christie sings his own songs the best because they belong to him. But you can always hear his own voice in the background, when, even when you're singing it as well.
If love is all they say, I'll take it all the way. Let's take it all the way.
There's a light above you.
I have never really had an opportunity before to work with Christie and or to show my appreciation in a tangible way for his art.
I'd written a song about 22 years ago for my brother who was going in for a singing competition. If he'd won, it was 2 weeks in Spain for two people. I had no idea, he had no intention of taking me. So anyway, he said, they love me, absolutely love me, but they hated the song, so I didn't get through. So he blamed me, really. So anyway, I'm a great believer in a good song. So if it's a good song, I find it really hard to take criticism on it. Like, you know, I will on more songs, but if I believe in it, I'll do anything to keep this baby alive. So I sent it off to lots of different people.
I got a song in the post, and it was one of Christie's songs.
I knew that Francis Black was making an album, and I sent Francis the song as a new song, probably live or Dave. And she covered it, and she got to number one with it. It was her first number one, called All the Lies You Told Me.
All the lies that you told me, all the tears that I've cried, all the loving you gave me, it was a lie.
It just put Francis on the map. It really, really did. And to this day, it's probably the most heavily requested song in her set.
It was the song for me that changed my life in this country. Absolutely changed my life.
Don't forget your shoes and socks and start to tie it on. Don't forget your shoes and socks and start to tie it on.
When I was listening to Don't Forget the Shovel, and it automatically feels that I'm actually playing a Kerry slide almost with the tune. And I've tried a few different things with it, and it's still coming back to this rhythm that's coming through the tune, and it's quite exciting, actually.
Tell me, sir, yeah, just how far I need to go to be a star.
He has a real talent as a producer, anyway, to get you to sing less, but put more heart into the music. Even though Christie makes it look so effortless, he has spent days, weeks, years perfecting his kind of craft, if you like.
Hey, Mr. Blue, say how do you do?
When I was in the studio today, I kept looking behind at Christie for his approval. Are
we
doing it right? Is that okay?
You're right, Christie.
Yeah, right, John, yeah.
Do you prefer it up high or low? What do you think?
I loved not the last one, but the one before that was lovely. Just, do you know your opening line, Victoria? What's the opening line, John?
The Hey, Mr. Blue.
Yeah, have we got that? Hey, Mr. Blue.
Just
Hey, Mr. Blue.
Blue.
Hey, Mr. Blue.
You just need to push the top of the note. Hey, Mr. Blue.
Okay.
You can just hit the top of the note.
Yeah.
Okay, we can do that.
Hey, Mr. Blue.
To this day, I hear him in my ear going, it's getting there. Yeah, it's getting there. I'd be like, just tell me, is it good? Is it rubbish? No, it's getting there.
Getting over you. Getting over you. Getting over you. Getting over you.
There was never a time I believed that I could write a song, and I still don't know how to write a song today. And the problem being is I have really bad dyslexia with the fear of reading and writing. So either the people who can help me to read and write can't help me because they don't understand dyslexia. People who understand dyslexia can't do anything because they don't understand the fear. So I'm in the middle at 62 years of age and still can't read and write. So.
How have you been able to cover it up, though, for all these years? I mean, you must have gone to some lengths, Christie.
I never really tried to cover it up. Somebody said to me, sign your autograph, and I'd sign it, and I'd be kind of looking at myself, is that nearly right, or is that... And then they'd look at it and go, that's the wrong fella. All I work is totally on blank tapes and just sit and sing rubbish for hours and hours and hours. And then I wait for inspiration from wherever it comes, but it comes out every time. I just have a plan, and the plan just seems to take place. And over the 10 tapes, it just seems to be a little jigsaw that keep building up and building up, and eventually the sound comes out.
Writing is an intellectual sort of exercise, you know, to try and translate what you're feeling. And I mean, if you don't have that, you know, your feelings come out another way, and your thoughts come out another way, and they're all the more individual for that, because you're not schooled through a system, you know. And that's why I think a lot of his songs sound so unusual.
Oh, when I go to bed at night, everything's all right, and Mom says out delight and says good night. Now I put my head underneath the clothes, dream of the things that I will do when I get old. Now I won't need a rocket to go to the moon, because I'll jump so high that I get there sooner than a rocket.
I can imagine that Christie would have tackled his illness, whatever you want to call it, in a methodical way, because that's his way of thinking.
I imagine the tumour being shrunk, you know, however, by this pale hands. And some days I might imagine some water just flowing through me, washing all the disease away, you know. I just need to be strong and believe, which I do believe. For my family's sake, I would change their whole life if I started being in misery, and, you know what I mean, and let this get me down. Eventually they'd come down there. So I asked them to just be as normal as they possibly can and forget about this. It's okay for me to deal with this. You don't have to deal with it right now.
He's determined to come through this, and we all have him in the white light.
It does help to get things into perspective, you know. So I really appreciate everybody around me, and the music, and my voice for the first time. I always took my voice for granted. I can sing, and good, I've worked on it. But it's not that, it's a gift. I just realise it's a gift, you know. And now I thank God for the gift that I've been given to sing, you know.
We had a great talk about the beauty of living life in the day, the preciousness of the 24-hour periods that we're given. And so I consider that moment to be a great blessing to me in my life, to have met Christie and to be given the opportunity to just share a song with him and to connect with his spirit and his greatness. It's a big deal. Words aren't enough sometimes.
I'm going to finish up on this one. It's called Roll Back the Clouds. And, thank you very much. Now, it seems like it's written for somebody trying to make it in the music business, but it wasn't really. It's everybody really trying to make it in anything that they want to make it in. And if you keep trying hard enough, I'm sure you'll make it eventually. Don't go by me there.
A fella called him a legend this morning, walking along the street, and I said, no, I said he wasn't a legend. Christie, I said, it was way beyond a legend. I said, it's bigger than a legend. I said, Christie was an artist. And I said, an artist lives forever.
And when your luck is all run out, you're asked to take a bow. You've just stolen the show, but now you're on your own. Yes, all right. Yeah, we'd sing our miles. My dream scene is me the star. Me a star. I am a star.